Sounds on?
Yep.
Awesome. So, Mama.
Yeah.
So, I'm going to spring this on you, and you can read as much of this as you want.
Okay. What if I can't do it?
I'll bet you can do it. I don't know if you've seen this in a while, but this is something you must have wrote when you were a teenager.
Really?
And it's called My Philosophy of Life by Marion Ross. I found it amongst some things.
What's the
date?
Have
you read this? It doesn't have a date on it, but it talks about you being... Anyway, have a read. Would you like to read it?
Well, and where did you find this?
In amongst some things, like some letters and things, old things.
My philosophy of life. Gee, I don't even know what the word means. I suppose it's something difficult like psychology. No, wait, maybe philosophy. That's what the old man with his feet up on the stove in the general store talks about when he tips back in his chair, or the old man who smokes his pipe at the world as he sits on the porch as the only hotel in a small town in Iowa. What is this about? I don't know. He has lived life almost to his close, and now he just sits back and wisely follows the new generation, smiling and shaking his head at all the silly things that children do, but really wishing that they would never change. Yes, philosophy is a simple thing. It belongs to simple, everyday people. It becomes complicated only by our interpretations. My philosophy started when I was a little girl, about 6 years old. I don't know who wrote this, but it's just a curious thing. One night, I'm beginning to remember this. One night, I lay in my bed looking up at the curtains of the pretty blue material with printed boys and girls playing in sandboxes on their folds, and I wasn't thinking about the curtains. I was thinking about the sky, and then I looked up, and I didn't see heaven. I just saw the sky, and it just went on and on and never ending sea of blueness, and soon became it would be black. What was up there? Beyond the sky. It couldn't just keep going. It had to stop. Everything ends sometime. That is, except in heaven. And how could it be that a person could live forever and ever? What is forever and ever? Everything I know has an ending. I could see myself peering down from a cloud upon the earth. It was round, suspended from a small pink ribbon running up until it was seen no more in the vast sea of blueness. I could see everything that was going on clearly. I recognized people. They were happy and they didn't miss me a bit, and I was dead. I woke up screaming. I was alone. Then my mother came in and took me in her arms. I sobbed, "Why doesn't the sky end?" "Well, there are so many things that neither you nor I understand, darling. But God knows. He must have you, we must have faith in him. He made the trees and us and everything. I'm sure he has made a place in heaven where little girls like you can be safe, where you will always be loved and needed and never left on the outside to see the others sitting along without you. Just believe in him. That's all you can do." And so I do believe in him. All of the geniuses in Greenwich Village can dissect religion and say they don't believe, but I do, and I am happy and secure. My dream of sitting on a cloud outside the world was horrifying. Everyone got along so easily without me. One day I was walking and I met an old man. He was talking to himself, renouncing the world, quite audibly. Then I started to see him. He quickened his pace and began to talk to me. He realized that I was young. He told me that he was 69. People wouldn't listen to what he had to say. They thought he was too old. I learned that he had formed some sort of an organization with a religious purpose, and he wanted to make the world conscious of what true brotherly love could do for humanity. I explained about how wonderful it would be to be able to look back over all of the things that had passed. He must be able to see that this world actually grow into what it is now. He said that the youth were always looking back. It is when you become so old as he was that one really looks ahead. He could have wanted nothing more than to be able to live forever and see what will happen to the world. He said, "Goodbye and God bless you." I never saw him again, but he made me think. His ideas on brotherly love, being the only survivor of the world, were right. And I stopped to think, how few people really love me. Well, maybe that was because I didn't really love them either. A friend will be a friend not because he loves you, but because he can get something out of that facade of friendship. If I could follow three little rules, generosity, consideration of people in what I say and consideration in what I do, I could make all the friends in the world. But how can one do this without losing all individuality and becoming a yes woman? But I have tried to consider, I've tried to be considerate and generous. Too many people have trampled on me. For almost a year, I have been living away from home, away from really the only place where one finds people who love me. Where I am living now, I am needed, so they treat me kindly. But at school, I offer the people nothing, and I find myself walking alone with my thoughts. I don't need to have people talking to me and constantly with me, but one of the things I seek most in life is having people smile, you know, at me so that I know they like me. I can be happy then, and that's what we all want above everything else, is happiness, you know. What is the purpose of living if we don't do some things good for humanity? I believe that life should be lived in such a way that it still be a record that we can proudly be tested by eternity. A person should strive to have an occupation that will benefit people of a community or further civilization. But I don't think one should force oneself into doing those things unless it is what he actually wants to do and will enjoy doing. I mean, a mother can persuade her son to become a minister, but he won't be successful unless he really feels in his heart that that is what he wants to do. I don't believe that God has willed it that we are to do certain things in life, but we ourselves feel we are meant to do them. We all have an abstract or material something that we are always striving to attain. I believe in those inner struggles. They make life worthwhile. They carry our hopes for the future over the many difficulties and disappointments of life. While there's a will, there's a way. it doesn't matter how one lives, just so he's living. That's hope. I believe in it.